clip. I guess they have learned from the kosher casino. I learned a little something today, too, about Gabe Hoffman. And I'll get back to all this. I'll get back to Gator. But you remember last year, you know, Gabe claims to be a hedge fund manager, but those claims looking to be false. Now, if you don't know what a hedge fund is, basically you manage other people's money. Maybe you have some of your own money in there too. But you invest on behalf of others, high-risk investments typically, you know, shorting stock, buying up stock with borrowed money, and things like that that are a little risque. It can be highly profitable if you make the right bets. But Gabe Hoffman, who's considered, I guess, like more of an expert in pharma, right? Shock. Maybe I'm more of an expert in pharma than him now that I think about it. But so he was on this, and we'll get back to the THORPs. I should never end. Gator, we got to cover that as well. And Riley and Mint coming up at 8. But he was on a mission. You don't have to search very hard to find this on YouTube. He shorted Tesla during the biggest bull run, one of the biggest bull runs in the history of the stock market. He thought it was going to be a good idea to short Tesla. There's even a video out there, Tesla below $10, and it's got Gabe Hoffman's face on there. Maybe I'll pull that up, actually. Tesla below $10? Let me see if I can find this. So anyway, last fall, I looked up his SEC paperwork, and I think somebody had tipped me off on it, and it showed that his hedge fund firm, Accipiter, which is a fancy word for hawk, basically, was defunct, and had been defunct almost a year to the day. What is today? The 17th. I think it's actually a year to the day. Let me see if I can pull this up. I believe it's 1 year to the day. No, okay, yesterday it was 1 year to the day. Terminated registration status. So if you don't know how a hedge fund worked, now he might have had some of his own money in there. I don't know. But he had a lot of other people's money in there too. And so a hedge fund operator collects fees basically off people to invest their money and make bets like this and do stuff like this. Now, it just so happened to be one of the worst bets in the last 20 years on the stock market, and Elon has celebrated it, and everybody's laughed at all these people who tried to short Tesla and failed miserably. And he went from a hedge fund with allegedly around $100 million in capital to he closed out his hedge fund with $3.77 million. And assets. So, I mean, you can do the math, but it's like a 96%. It's like a 96% loss in capital there. But he probably still made some money off this, because, you know, I doubt that he went fully broke off this, because he got, you know, hedge fund fees and money management fees from all these people for the biggest losing bet, like I said, in the last 20 years. So he probably still made some money. Now, I don't know how much of his own money was in there and how much he was betting personally, so we can only speculate on that. But we do know, courtesy of the SEC, and all these are available publicly online, that he went from allegedly around $100 million of capital in his Accipiter hedge fund down to $3.77 million. And I actually didn't see that part last year. I would have brought that up. But I got another tip today and said, dig a little deeper. Hit this next little button over here, and you can see what he filed in terms of assets left under his control. And it's defunct. Like, this thing doesn't exist anymore. There is no more Accipiter. According to the SEC, there is no more Accipiter. There is no more hedge fund. I don't know what he's got. Maybe he's got another one on the side or something. Who could say? But you know, his big ballin accipiter hedge fund is defunct and has been defunct for a full year, and he basically lost everything on comments like these and bets like these. And I'll just let you watch this.
In the towel, Wilf. I do think that you are seeing. Look, just look at the estimates in terms of how much they now expect the company to lose this year. We ran down this yesterday on Fast Money at 5 o'clock. I think like a month and a half ago, people were expecting them to make $550.
Now this is 5 years ago. So this is 2019, and he spent. If you go look at his timeline, he's still psychotic about Tesla. Well, it's too late now. No matter what happens, because you lost all your shorts, but. Literally lost your shorts. So it doesn't really matter now if it goes down to 10, which won't happen. But anyway, this is him in 2019. And there's video after video of this, by the way.
Share this year. Now they're expecting him to lose $1.16 a share. I mean, that has just plunged within the last two.
And if you remember at the time, there was like a huge short movement on Tesla. And Elon crushed the shorters is what he did, and it was a bloodbath, and Gabe Hoffman was allegedly a big part of that bloodbath.
Last quarter, I should say, and a lot of that is because people are saying you had to take out more capital, you're going to lose money at least into the fourth quarter likely, and then even if you look into the fourth quarter, are you confident that the demand is there in order to turn a profit?
So, Gabe, you've been on our show a lot. You're very bearish on Tesla. I think you...
Very bearish on Tesla. And there's literally just at the, and there's probably more than this, but just a cursory search and you can see him on CNBC like trumpeting this just all the time. Tesla going to $10. Spoiler alert, that didn't happen. I think it went to like $400. Where's it at right now? I think it might be down a little bit now. Oh, no, let me see, U.S. dollars, I don't want it in. Yeah, so the stock price today is much more, it's down, it's like 187. But, and that's for a variety of reasons, and his pay package and all this. X probably didn't help, some other things, but not $10. Not $10.
Might be the one person who.
But it went up to $400. And if you know anything about shorting, which I admit that I don't know that much, but if you make a bet on a short and you borrow the money to buy the short, do you understand? Like, I don't want to pretend like I'm an expert, but you borrow the money to execute the short position. And then when it's called in, when you lost your bet, they call it in, and then you have to pay it back. The Big Short, you could watch that movie. There's other people who could explain it to you a lot better than I can. But you typically used borrow money to execute these sorts of maneuvers. Now, if they work, they work great, and you make a killing. But when they don't work, accipiter hedge fund goes under.
Can it go to 10 bucks?
Oh, I believe that ultimately Tesla will go to zero.
Now, this is a guy who basically lost all of his hedge fund, stepping outside of his zone. Now, even the person, and I'll show you the quote a minute ago, was like, oh, this guy actually knows a little bit about pharma stocks and stuff like that. But he lost his lunch. He lost his shirt. He lost his pants. He lost his everything, his shoes. No shirt, no shoes, no service off shorting Tesla. And he just knew this was going to happen. He said Tesla was going to go to zero. Now think about, that's like Tim Pool's prediction that Trump's going to win all 50 states. Remember that from 2020? It's like just insanity. But let's continue.
Any company that's losing billions of dollars and struggling under a mountain of over $10 billion in debt and over $3 billion of current accounts payable due on the desk, that's a real problem. With this analyst's work, I have a bigger problem. That is,
oh, yeah?
Adam Jonas has almost 350,000 deliveries projected for 2019. That's in line with Elon Musk's guidance of 90 to 100,000 each quarter for the second through fourth quarter, which is almost a 50% jump from what we saw in the first. Now, I told CNBC viewers multiple times during the first quarter why it would be a disaster on volume, price, and margins. And given that we're halfway through the second quarter, I do have projections which are very different from...
It would have been a great... You're right, Galactic. You're so right. It would have been a great idea if it worked. If it worked, he would have been swimming Scrooge McDuck style in coins, right? Like, I mean, if it would have worked, it would have been one of the all-time greatest deals. No doubt about that. Yeah, I'll say that. Yeah, if it would have worked, it would have been like Nostradamus type shit if it would have worked. The only problem is it was in the middle of, like, the biggest bull run in history. And, you know, Elon's also propped up by government contracts and SpaceX and all this other money. So...
What is your view, though, Gabe, about the fact that they got away that fundraising recently? Does that delay at least your call that it's one day going to hit zero?
Well, sure.
It's not going to hit zero. There are junk bonds. It's going to hit zero.
Tesla went from a very desperate financial situation, barely able to keep the doors open, and they got enough cash to last them maybe another 6-9 months. Remember, you have to subtract the $300 million that Elon Musk basically burned away, hedging dilution from the convert at $300, and then subtract the over $500 million of debt that's due in November. When you run through the model, what I project for the second quarter, based on state registration data and extrapolating some international individual registration data from countries, I get around 75,000 deliveries for the second quarter. That's well below Adam Jonas and others' 90 to 100,000. And then in Q3, I actually have a drop rather than a gain due to the 1875 of federal tax credit rolling off. So that'll consume most of the cash that Tesla raised by about Thanksgiving.
That did not happen. Now, most of these are old. Let me see. I'm trying to find another one. Like 2019, he was out there like every day promoting this. Well, as many times as they would let him on TV. Now here he goes against somebody else, and I won't spend too much time on this, but he still goes on and on about Tesla daily on his timeline. I mean, it's over now. I don't know why, but
you know, I have a counter because Gabe is gaslighting for the coal company that he owns, and the fact
the coal company he owns. Now wait a minute, I didn't know that.
Gabe has 50% of his assets in a coal company, and he's short.
Really? Wait a minute. Oh, we came with some exclusives here, huh? Oh, I didn't know that. Coal burning Gabe.
I have a counter because Gabe is gaslighting for the coal company that he owns, and the fact that Gabe has 50% of his assets in a coal company, and he's short the clean energy future, is very disingenuous, because the fact of the matter is Tesla's trying...
Man, this guy's roasting him.
...to solve an incredibly important goal for our society. It's not just about making money, which is important, and building cars. It's about creating an EV infrastructure and future for all transportation companies. And Tesla's been successful at this. So instead of just being this guy who hates Elon Musk, you got to focus on the real company. And the company's going to achieve, like, huge numbers over the next 6 months. We expect them reaching all of their financial goals, $20 billion in revenue in the next 12 months, $1.5 billion in EBITDA, and we expect a $100 billion market cap in the next 12 months, and Elon getting his stock award. So I think Gabe really just should stop moonlighting for the coal companies.
Well, Gabe, are you long coal, short Tesla?
I do have some coal positions.
It's 50% of your fund. It's 50%.
It's not 50% of my fund.
You just disclosed it on your 13F in a public filing.
Hey, Ross, how many car companies do you know power with coal? I thought so.
How about coal is the biggest contributor to climate change of any thing.
Yeah, guys, we're getting off topic. I would say, Ross, I would say, actually, it would seem like you'd want to own coal if you were short Tesla, maybe because it takes coal to make the power to run the Tesla. That aside, Ross.
It does not take coal to run the power.
Let's talk about
30% of the electric grid. We're not going to get in the electric grid, but I'm not agreeing or disagreeing. I'm just saying
that Gabe has an agenda. Gabe has an agenda.
You don't say.
But we're here trying to make the world a better place. That's all I'm saying.
Okay,
let's talk about Tesla's financials.
Let's talk about the balance sheet. Ross, does it bother you at all that Tesla is asking people for $2,500 to confirm their orders and customize their car? Do you think that's worrisome in any way?
No, not at all. In fact, the way it works, because I just bought one and got one, is that you put a $1,000 deposit. When you're ready to configure the car, you put in $2,500.
Now, notice that Tesla had already went to $335. Was that $2-something before? So Gabe's already eating shit.
So that they actually build the car for you that you want, and then when you deliver the car, you have to pay for the full amount of the car. That's the way it works when you order a Tesla. Now, the fact that they've opened up reservations to all reservation holders, and yet reservations continue to increase, so they are filling 20,000, 30,000 orders and getting just as many new reservations, I think that's something that people should consider here. This is a huge piece of good news.
All right, continues to be such a battleground, guys. We've run out of time. Thank you both.
And there's one more. There's several, but I'm not going to play them all.
All right, Tesla shares plunging more than 12% since Wednesday. This comes after posting a larger-than-expected loss in the second quarter earnings update, also announcing that co-founder and CTO J.B. Straubel would be leaving the company. Here to discuss what's driving Tesla and what to do after a bad week for the stock, Gabe Hoffman, owner and general partner at Accipiter Capital Management.
No longer the case. It's a defunct company, and I can pull that up on your screen. Again, that's what they ended with. And, you know, $3, $4 million, $3.77 million. Not bad, but when it's down from allegedly $100 million. Now, this is the tip that I got. Gabe Hoffman took a $100 million portfolio and consistently lost on puts outside of his expertise. Pharma would be his expertise. His fund, Accipiter, had less than $5 million this time last year when he filed the ADVW to terminate. And again, all this is online. You can just type in Accipiter and ADVW, and these forms will come up online. They're publicly available. Still has hedge fund in his Twitter bio to make him seem smart when he shitposts. He lost it all on Tesla puts from 2019 onward, LOL. I wish I could make millions in fees while making one of the worst trades possible. Now, again, he still made some money off this. Other people's money he wasted. And no telling how many, you know, retirement savings and, you know, personal savings just went up in smoke because Gabe was selling a bunch of bullshit. And maybe he really believed it. I don't know. But it was a dumb call.
Management, along with Gene Munster, managing partner at Loop Ventures. Always a good time for a Tesla debate, gentlemen. Thanks for joining us. So, Gabe, what did you learn?
Who was the Israeli who bought the property in Palm Beach? That would be Larry Ellison. But I guess I don't know if he's dual citizen or not. But
this week, that gave you more fuel for your short argument.
Yes, that's pretty much correct, Dusted. That's pretty much correct.
Talked about to CNBC viewers all year has been proven right again. The second quarter was another disaster. Yes, Tesla moved metal, but they had to cut price thousands of dollars, so margins were a disaster. They lost a lot more money than investors expected. You know, about 5 months ago, Gene and I were here together on CNBC, and
did you see what that said?
Expected.
Gabe Hoffman, Tesla, disclosure, largest short position. He had the largest short position against Tesla in the entire stock market. He had the largest short position and was crushed.
You know, about 5 months ago, Gene and I were here together on CNBC, and I talked about the first quarter being a disaster.
The largest short position in the entire fucking stock market.
And I asked Gene, what type of miss would it take to get you to change your mind? He said about 20-30%, and that happened, and the stock was 60 points higher then. I'd love to know what he's thinking today.
Gene?
Well, you know, maybe before we, the simple answer is that they had some pretty big upside in the March quarter. I think when we were talking 6 months ago, I said that 2019 is going to be a transition year. Undoubtedly, there's going to be ups and downs. We had a down in the March quarter, massive miss, as you just discussed. But on the flip side, in the June quarter, there was significant upside going from 53 to 78,000 Model 3s. I would also like to just quickly point out, I think that part of that dip more recently is around the loss, the margins. But I think around the brain drain, I just want to quickly address that brain drain question here. And the best perspective is J.B. Straubel has been associated as kind of the co-creator of Tesla. In fact, that's not true.
Tesla stock split 15 times since Gabe invested.
What J.B. is.
Keep that in mind.
is the best analogy is he is the candy man. He is not Willy Wonka. Often those two people are considered the same person. As long as Elon Musk is in the reins and they're continuing to grow their vehicles, I'm
going to
probably continue to believe in this story.
Gabe, I mean, you know, for a long time, the story with Tesla was if only they can get production up to roughly the level they're at, it seems like they might be able to attain scale and kind of have their place in the industry. Now there's all these questions about the margins and, in fact, just how big the ultimate opportunity is. What did this quarter tell you about those questions?
This quarter told me
all right, now we'll pull up a little bit more here.
Car in the Model 3. It's near the bottom of Consumer Reports rankings. It's got a design flaw. You just saw a story out this week about how it catches about 15 pounds of dust and dirt underneath, and they had to chop price down to 50. It's going even lower.
Right?
They cut price again in July. So,
okay, now let me read this
demand.
To you guys. So here's all Gabe's 13F filings of holdings, and we'll look at that. Tesla split 15 times since Gabe invested. 3-1 times 3 times 15. That was in 2022. 20.25-1 times 5 times 5. A 5x split and a 3x split. So the price to compare is 15x what it says now. Again, I'm not an expert in these things, but sounds very bad.
But it's at a price that Tesla can't make money and they lose a ton of money. With the brain drain, it's important to note this is two out of the last three quarters that you had a major executive departure during the quarter. If you look back at the 2018 proxy, there's only one guy left, Elon Musk, out of the named executives, the CFO, chief technology officer, head of marketing and sales, head of manufacturing. They're all gone. If you go to the Twitter, you know, Tesla executive departures, you'd see out of the top 100, most of them have left over the last year. I mean, Tesla's got more executive turnover than a McDonald's.
So, Gene, I mean, I know the brain drain you think isn't as bad as feared. What about the profitability question, the fact that margins were such a miss and that even if they can deliver on target, it's going to be hard to do so profitably?
So the price to compare what it is now is a 5X and a 3X split. So the price to compare is 15X what it says now. Because of the stock splits. Now, again, I know we're getting into the weeds here, but
Becky, Sarah, I'd say that the 1% miss in gross margins was just that. I understand direction. It's gone from 24 to 20 to 19, and investors get concerned about that.
Who knows how long he held this position? Well, at least since 2019, and we'll pull this up. Accipiter Capital Management LLC filing history. Now, let me see if I can get this on your screen here. This is all public data, by the way. He likes to LARP as this financial genius. Not quite the case. So you'll see, and I think it may have even began in 2018, but these are reported value in thousands, right? So when it says 123,000, that's 123 million, I believe, in value. So he went from, in 2018, I believe I'm reading this correctly, by the way. $300 million in 2018 in August. And then in November, it was $123 million. And then last year, when he filed what he filed to end his... Did you see terminated there on the screen? He ended with $3.775 million. So yeah, you might be right. Now those his personal holdings, I don't know, I'll have to dig into these a little bit more. Let's see. Assets under management. The market value column should not be used as a substitute for assets under management as it does not include cash held in accounts. But you can see the drastic drop-off, and this is from 2018. But it ended with his company in the shitter. So Isaac says, no way he's gambling with $100 million of his own money. Well, I would doubt that myself, yeah. Current market value, no, I was correct. as of 2018, his current market value was $123 million. So I was correct. No, not $1.23 million. $123 million in 2018. You see that on your screen, right? You see it highlighted there? So he went from $123 million in 2018 assets, current market value of his hedge fund. He went to $3.77 million and he closed his Accipiter hedge fund all off his Tesla bet. Presumably most of it off his Tesla bet. We'll be careful with our language here. But
in the grand scheme of things, you need to take that into the context of how much cash they have. They have $5 billion in cash. If they continue at this a pace where effectively they would come in, let's say, 10 to 15% below their targets over the next 6 quarters, they'll have enough cash for the next 2 years. When I think about the margin question, it needs to be in the context of cash. I'm not trying to make excuses for the fact that they are losing share. I'm simply pointing out that when you transform an industry, there is an incredible amount of pain. Tesla's going through that. It is as evidenced in some of the turnover because it is an intense environment to work and also in the margins. But I'm confident in this theme, and we talked about this 6 months ago. The future is electrification. There is no chance that gas vehicles will be powering the world in 100 years. And if you do believe in that...
Well, maybe not 100, but for the next 20 or 30.
I think that the other automotive makers are materially behind, and I think that it's the right thing to do to invest in the business right now.
And no wonder he's hanging around the sector, by the way, because, I mean, his financial life just has to be completely crushed. You know, I said forever. Let me see, let me type this out. I mean, when you lose a bet this big, people aren't exactly rushing out to reinvest. They're not exactly running out to reinvest with you, Gabe. And, you know, you can LARP all you want, but the facts are the facts. And we're looking at them right here. And the funny thing is, I found this form, this original form, last year, but I didn't click the second part that showed what he ended up with, right, in terms of cash, assets under management, which is, like I said, around $3.8 million, down from $123 million in 2018. So he basically seemingly lost it all off trying to short Tesla, and, you know, source talking to mentions the stock splits. All that plays into it as well, and it just makes it comically insane, and you can see why he's obsessed with Elon Musk, and every day he's tweeting something about Tesla, and it's kind of comical. At this point, I think I would just, you know, maybe lay off the Tesla predictions, and also... You know, he's never beating those street Jew accusations anymore. I don't think that that's Denise. Is she still in the chat? I don't think he's beating Denise's claim that he's a street Jew. He should have stuck to pharma, it looks like, because it looks like he was making, you know, pretty good money. And, you know, going all the way back to 2013. Now, the money fluctuates because he's taking bets and, you know, moving around funds and this and that. But he... We don't know exactly when he went short on Tesla. Was it 2018 or 2019? But he went from $300 million in 2018 to $123 later in 2018, 3 months later. And then he went to 3.8 when he folded up his hedge fund shop last year. Now, does he have something else going on? I don't know. And again... There's rules in place, so we don't know how much of his own money was invested in that. There's like a one-year hold. Like, you can't just cash out if you're a hedge fund manager either. There's like all these rules and stuff like that. So if he did have some of his own money in there, there's restrictions and stuff like that. Hedge funds are a little dodgy, if you ask me. But they're very dodgy, in my opinion, if Gabe Hoffman's running them. So, yeah, he basically lost it all on betting against Tesla. And it's funny because if he would have shorted them like a few years later, because it was at like, I think it was at like 400 last year. Now, if he would have shorted them at like, what, 180 or some shit like that, when they were at 400, he would have made a lot of money. So basically, he picked the wrong time to short them. If he would have shorted them later on, and again, I won't explain shorting. Some of you know what I'm talking about here. Some of you don't. Basically, you bet that a stock is going to underperform. Usually, you use money under your control, or you borrow money saying that it's going to hit this price point by a certain date. If it hits that price point, you win. If it doesn't, you lose everything. So that's the layman's version of how stock shorting works. And again, I won't pretend to be an expert because I'm not. And it doesn't seem like Gabe Hoffman is an expert either. So I just thought I would go over, you know, Gabe likes to talk a lot of shit about what a financial wizard he is and this and that. And as I have more time to pour over these numbers, these just came in to me today. And again, not exactly my, you know, forte, you know, hedge funds and, you know, the ins and outs of the stock market. But you don't have to be, you know, Charles Schwab to figure out that this was a big mistake. You're describing options, not shorts. Well, I can show you a video on shorts if you'd like. Let me see here. This is a very simple video. What is short selling? It's very short, too.
What is short selling? Presented by WallStreetSurvivor.com. Short selling is a risky way to profit from declining stock prices. Basically, it is a bet against a stock or company. When you
did I not just say that? But anyway, again, I'm not the expert here.
Buy a stock, you expect the price to go up. On the other hand, when you short a stock, you expect the price to go down. Shorting a stock is the inverse of buying a stock, which is often referred to as going long. Here's Jack. Jack has heard that Goliath National Bank is in financial trouble and expects their stock price to go down. In order to profit from his prediction, Jack will short GNB. But how does this work? Jack calls his broker and tells him that he wants to short one share of GNB. To do this, the broker needs to find one share to lend to Jack. The broker can look in a few different places, including his stock inventory and his clients' portfolios. If he still can't find the stock, he can ask other brokers. Jack's broker finds the share in one of his clients' portfolios and borrows it. The broker will then sell the share on the market for Jack. GNB's stock was trading at $100, which will be credited to Jack's brokerage account. Jack was right. After a week, GNB's financial struggles are made public and the stock price drops to $70. Because the stock price dropped and Jack made a bet against the stock, Jack stands to make a profit by buying back or covering GNB. Jack calls his broker and tells him to cover his position in GNB. The broker uses the money from Jack's brokerage account to buy one share of the stock from the market at the current price of $70 and returns the stock to his client's portfolio. Jack sold GNB stock for $100 and bought it back for $70. Awesome! Jack made a profit of $30. Jack also has to pay a small fee to the broker for the right to borrow the stock. Short selling is for advanced traders because it can be extremely risky. Unlike buying a stock or going long, where your losses are limited, your losses are unlimited when you short.
See, that's the key part. Watch The Big Short, also a great film. But
your losses are unlimited. Consider this graph of price versus profit. Let's say you buy a stock for $100. The most you can possibly lose is the amount that you paid for it, in this case $100. As the stock price goes up, your profits will continue to go up as well. Theoretically, there is no limit to how high the price can go. Now consider that you have shorted the same stock at $100. In this case, you profit when the price decreases. The most you could stand to make is the price that you shorted at, in this case $100. However, as the price goes up, your losses go up. And since there is no limit to how high the stock price can go up, Theoretically, there is no limit to how much you can lose. While shorting is an effective way to make money when stock prices go down, make use of stop orders to minimize your risk. To practice short selling risk-free, sign up at Wall Street.
Basically, it's an unlimited. There's no limit to what you can lose if you're not. Sounds like a certain type of talk. Yes. Yes, that's right. You just explained what the video said. Shorting is technically a potentially bigger loss. If you buy a stock normally at 50, the most you can lose is $50. If you are short at 50 and the stock goes to 1,000, you lose $995. Yes, and when he was talking about shorting Tesla, it was at like 195, 200. Well, Tesla stock eventually went to like 400 and something. Now it's back down now, but Tesla stock like went to the moon. So that's seemingly why he no longer has, you know, his accipiter hedge fund management. And this is all layman's analysis. I saw somebody in chat said he will threaten to sue me over this. Well, these are all publicly available documents. And, you know, I'm saying allegedly, I don't know, maybe he had other investments. I just know he was on CNBC almost daily talking this shit up. And he was listed on CNBC as the largest short. He held the largest short position in Tesla. They said that on the screen. I didn't say that. He held the largest short position in Tesla. And it didn't work out. And now there is no more accipiter hedge fund. Now, maybe he's reconstituted into something else. I'm sure a guy like him probably has. But these are all publicly available documents. All these interviews are out there in public. Like, there's no... You know, there's no chicanery here. You just, it's a simple Google search away. And I'm sure there's even more information out there if you want to do a little bit of digging. But, I'm pretty sure I'm fairly accurate in how I've described that. So, still obsessed with Tesla. I don't know if he said anything about what I put out today. I don't really know what he could sue me over, but, you know. I don't really care either. Hedge fund manager. Oh, he's talking about Skrelly. He should have probably stuck with Skrelly. See, he's still talking about Elon. Elon Musk and the SEC are on a collision course again. SEC likely to seek enforcement action, barring Elon Musk as a public company officer / director, former SEC officials say. So, yeah, it's all about AVPAC, and it's all about Elon Musk. So, I mean, literally, tweet after tweet about Elon Musk. So, we'll see. We'll stay in tune on that. But I see some info in the chat. Gabe owned over 25%. Really? Now, that's coming from the chat. That's not me saying that. So that means a lot of his own money was tied up into this. I mean, you can just do the math here on your own. But he owned 25% of the company, according to chat here. Accipiter was founded in 2002 by its principal owner and managing member, Gabe Hoffman. Mr. Hoffman is the only person that owns more than 25% of Accipiter. Accipiter serves as investment manager too. And then this is a link from the SEC, I believe, from 2020. I'm just scrolling through it. This is a pretty long link. I would probably do some more research on this off air. This just came to my attention today. So respect to the client fund, asset based fee to 2%, performance based compensation 20%. Well, it didn't seem like there was a lot of that after a certain point, but let's see. The minimum initial investment required for investment in the client fund is $1 million. The general partner may waive this minimum at its sole discretion. So this is like a brochure laying out the rules of his company. So, well, former company. And, yeah, this is from 2020. And I'll have to go through this a little bit on my own. Because it looks a little suspect. But all this stuff's out there. And he's been LARPing as this big, financial genius. He's been quiet recently. Yeah, I wonder why. But again, this was just brought to my attention. Oh, yeah, you're right. I didn't think about that. It's not back down now because it split so many times. Yeah, because there's more stocks out there. Do people know? Do we have to explain stock splitting as well? We're going to learn some things today. Can we hit the goal? Powerchat.live/TheRawForTorque. We'll go into some drama here in a second. I would say this is drama as well. But just so we know. So if it's at 400 and there's less stocks, right? When a stock splits, that means there's more stocks created. So anyway, I'll let this video explain it. I don't know if this is so technically it's not down. Yeah, actually was wrong with my, again, I'm not an expert here. So when a stock splits, there's more stocks.
Stocks go up, they go down, they go sideways.
True.
And sometimes they do something you might not expect. They split. There are two types of stock splits, conventional and reverse. A conventional stock split occurs when a company divides its existing shares into more shares. The number of shares increases, but the price of each share decreases.
See?
So the total value of the company...
I actually described it correctly.
...company's shares remains the same. Think of it like cutting a cake. Cutting more pieces doesn't mean you have less cake. You just have smaller pieces. For example, in June 2014, Apple split 7-for-1, meaning each share became 7. Apple went from having roughly 861 million outstanding shares at about $645 per share to about 6 billion shares at about $92 per share. Despite there being more shares, the total value of Apple's market cap remained the same at roughly $555 billion.
Very good explainer here, by the way.
A company typically splits its stock when the price of its shares is high. High prices can make it difficult for many investors to buy the standard trading unit of 100 shares. Ideally, a lower price allows more investors to buy the stock, potentially increasing its liquidity. So, what happens if you own a stock that splits? Just like a split doesn't change the total value of the company's shares, it doesn't change the total value of your shares. Let's return to the Apple example. If you had owned one share at $645 before the split, you would have owned 7 shares at around $92 after the split, give or take a few cents when rounding the numbers. The total value of the shares would still be $645. One common belief that investors have regarding stock splits is that a stock's price will go up after a split. But splits do not guarantee that a stock's value will go up. Investors should do additional research and look at the stock's overall financial health. The opposite of a conventional stock split is a reverse stock split. During a reverse stock split, a company decreases its number of shares in order to increase the price of each share. Companies often choose to enact a reverse stock split when shares fall below the minimum price of the exchange listing requirements. Stocks that fall below the exchange minimum.
God.
Revan JJ sent $5 on Rumble. My fee for missing so many is Hulk Hogan's top 10 moments according to the WWE. It's great that you are forming people on the market. So few know how they are manipulated and how to DIY it.
Well, yeah, and I only know the, like, very basics, and so, you know, I want to make sure this is explained correctly. It's not back down because it split so many times, source telling me correctly, who knows a lot more about the stock market than I do. And then this source, not me saying this, by the way, says he probably had to close his company because he couldn't cover any higher stock price. That seems like a likely case, like a likely case scenario. And Elon said he was going to crush the short sellers, and he did. So now has he made every right move since then? Well, you know, that's up to you to judge, but he definitely did crush the short sellers.
Thank you for watching this clip by Colonel J. This is the King of Bold here. Remember to like and subscribe. Juice!